Good evening, friends, fiends, and night owl supremes. Welcome to A Bit Late. Tonight is a pretty big deal. We are ending our story, The Turn of the Screw by Henry James, which is one of the stories that The Haunting of Bly Manor is based on. This is chapters 23 and 24 of Henry James's story, and we are going to wrap up a lot of loose ends. So far, the story has been spooky here and there. We see some ghosts or some deceased people walking among the living. But all questions should be answered in these two final chapters. Thank you for sticking around with me for this whole story. I am excited to wrap it up and to see just what happens and how everything works out, because this story has been one of miscommunication, like every fairy tale. Wow, I guess that's what makes stories stories. Really quickly, to recap what we read last time in chapter 21 and 22, Mrs. Grose reveals that she all along had proof of Miss Jessel's interfering with Flora. That would have been super helpful this whole time, because the governess was trying to convince Mrs. Grose that something was wrong, and Mrs. Grose was like, oh, I don't know. Really, there was something wrong, and Mrs. Grose knew about it the whole time. Anyway, the governess decides that the best thing to do would be to get Flora out of Bly and to her uncle in London, the one who doesn't want to have anything to do with the children. She worries the letter she sent will arrive before them, but then Mrs. Grose also tells her that the letter was never sent, because she thinks Miles stole it when they were out by the pond looking for Flora. Wow, who would have guessed? I mean, the governess did just kind of leave it out on a table and ran off. Communications and missing communications, yes. Flora and Mrs. Grose head out for London the following morning, leaving Miles and the governess alone for a very silent and very awkward dinner. The comparison the governess draws for that meal is kind of awkward. She compares them to a newly married couple on a honeymoon. Both parties are too embarrassed or shy to talk to the other party in front of other people. So, yeah, that was a weird thing. But anyway, we left off just as she and Miles were about to have the whole spooky thing out. Miles says, oh, so they're alone now, and the governess is about to bring her case forward, finally getting to the bottom of this thing. So, without further ado, get comfy, get cozy, get settled, gather your coffee, your tea, your animal familiars, pillows, blankets, candles, fairy lights, everything you need for the conclusion of The Turn of the Screw by Henry James. The Turn of the Screw, Chapter 23. Miles says, well, so we're alone. Oh, more or less, said the governess. I fancy my smile was pale. Not absolutely. We shouldn't like that, I went on. No, I suppose we shouldn't. Of course, we have the others. We have the others. We have indeed the others, I concurred. That even though we have them, he returned, still with his hands in his pockets and planted there in front of me, they don't much count, do they? I made the best of it, but I felt one. It depends on what you call much. Yes, with all accommodation, everything depends. On this, however, he faced to the window again and presently reached it with his vague, restless, cogitating step. He remained there a while, with his forehead against the glass, in contemplation of the stupid shrubs I knew and the dull things of November. I had always my hypocrisy of work, behind which, now, I gained the sofa. Steadying myself with it there, as I had repeatedly done at those moments of torment which I have described as the moments of my knowing the children to be given to something from which I was barred, I sufficiently obeyed my habit of being prepared for the worst. I understand that. But an extraordinary impression dropped on me as I extracted a meaning from the boy's embarrassed back, none other than the impression that I was not barred now. This inference grew in a few minutes to sharp intensity and seemed bound up with the direct perception that it was positively he who was. The frames and squares of the great window were a kind of image for him, of a kind of failure. I felt that I saw him at any rate, shut in or shut out. He was admirable, but not comfortable. I took it in with a throb of hope. Wasn't he looking, through the haunted pane, for something he couldn't see? And wasn't it the first time in this whole business that he had known such a lapse? The first, the very first. I found it a splendid portent. I made him anxious, though he watched himself. He had been anxious all day, and even while in his usual sweet little manner, he sat at the table, had needed all his small, strange genius to give it a gloss. When he at last turned round to meet me, it was almost as if his genius had succumbed. Well, I think I'm glad Bly agrees with me. You would certainly seem to have seen, these 24 hours, a good deal more of it than for some time before, I hope, I went on bravely, that you've been enjoying yourself. Oh yes, I've been ever so far, all around about, miles and miles away. I've never been so free. He really had a manner of his own, and I can only try to keep up with him. Well, do you like it? He stood there smiling, then at last he put into two words, Do you? More discrimination than I had ever heard two words contain. Before I had time to deal with that, however, he continued as if with the sense that this was an impertinence to be softened. Nothing could be more charming than the way you take it, for of course, if we're alone together now, it's you that are alone most. But I hope, he threw in, you don't particularly mind. Having to do with you, I asked. My dear child, how can I help minding? Though I've renounced all claim to your company, you're so beyond me. What? I at least greatly enjoy it. What else should I stay on for? He looked at me more directly, and the expression on his face, graver now, struck me as the most beautiful I had ever found on it. You stay on just for that? Certainly, I stay on as your friend and from the tremendous interest I take in you till something can be done for you that may be more worth your while. That needn't surprise you. My voice trembled so that I felt it impossible to suppress the shake. Don't you remember how I told you, when I came in and sat on your bed the night of the storm, that there was nothing in the world I wouldn't do for you? Yes, yes. He, on his side, more and more visibly nervous, had a tone to master. But he was so much more successful than I that, laughing out through his gravity, he could pretend we were pleasantly jesting. Only that, I think, was to get me to do something for you. It was partly to get you to do something, I conceded. But, you know, you didn't do it. Oh, yes, he said with the brightest superficial eagerness. You wanted me to tell you something. That's it. Out, straight out. What you have on your mind, you know. Ah, then is that what you've stayed over for? He spoke with a joviality through which I could still catch the finest little quiver of resentful passion. But I can't begin to express the effect upon me of an implication of surrender even so faint. It was as if what I had yearned for had come at last only to astonish me. Well, yes, I may as well make a clean breast of it. It was precisely for that. He waited so long that I supposed it for the purpose of repudiating the assumption on which my action had been founded. But what he finally said was, Do you mean now? Here? There couldn't be a better place or time. He looked round him uneasily, and I had the rare, oh, the odd impression of the first symptom I had seen in him of the approach of immediate fear. It was as if he were suddenly afraid of me, which struck me indeed as perhaps the best thing to make him. Yet, in the very pang of the effort, I felt it vain to try sternness, and I heard myself the next instant so gentle as to almost be grotesque. You want so to go out again? Awfully, he smiled at me heroically, and the touching little bravery of it was enhanced by his actually flushing with pain. He had picked up his hat, which he had brought in, and stood twirling in a way that gave me, even as I was just nearly reaching port, a perverse horror of what I was doing. To do it in any way was an act of violence. For what did it consist of but the obtrusion of the idea of grossness and guilt on a small, helpless creature who had been for me a revelation of the possibilities of beautiful intercourse? What? Wasn't it base to create for a being so exquisite a mere alien awkwardness? I suppose I now read into our situation the clearness it couldn't have had at the time, for I seemed to see our poor eyes already lighted with some spark of a prevision of the anguish that was to come. So we circled about, with terrors and scruples like fighters not daring to close. But it was for each other we feared. That kept us a little longer suspended and unbruised. I'll tell you everything, Miles said. I mean, I'll tell you anything you like. You'll stay on with me, and we shall both be all right. And I will tell you, I will, but not now. Why not now? My insistence turned him from me and kept him once more at his window in a silence during which, between us, you might have heard a pin drop. Then he was before me again with the air of a person for whom, outside, someone who had frankly to be reckoned with was waiting. I have to see Luke. I had not yet reduced him to quite so vulgar a lie, and I felt proportionately ashamed. But, horrible as it was, his lies made up my truth. I achieved thoughtfully a few loops of my knitting. Well then, go to Luke, and I'll wait for what you promise. Only, in return for that, satisfy before you leave one very much smaller request. He looked at me as if he felt he had succeeded enough to be able still a little to bargain. Very much smaller. Yes, a mere fraction of the whole. Tell me. Oh, my work preoccupied me, and I was offhand. If yesterday afternoon, from the table in the hall, you took, you know, my letter. Of course he did. Dun dun dun. The Turn of the Screw, Chapter 24. My sense of how he received this suffered for a minute from something that I can describe only as a fierce split of my attention. A stroke that at first, as I sprang straight up, reduced me to the mere blind movement of getting hold of him, drawing him close, and, while I just fell for support against the nearest piece of furniture, instinctively keeping him with his back to the window. The appearance was full upon us that I had already had to deal with here. Peter Quint had come into view like a sentinel before a prison. The next thing I saw was that, from outside, he had reached the window, and then I knew that, close to the glass and glaring through it, he offered once more to the room his white face of damnation. It represents but grossly what took place within me at the sight to say that on the second my decision was made. Yet I believe that no woman so overwhelmed ever in so short a time recovered her grasp of the act. It came to me in the very horror of the immediate presence that the act would be, seeing and facing what I saw and faced, to keep the boy himself unaware. The inspiration, I call it by no other name, was that I felt how voluntarily, how transcendentally I might. It was like fighting with a demon for a human soul, and when I had fairly so appraised it that I saw the human soul, held it out in the tremor of my hands at arm's length, had a perfect dew of sweat on a lovely childish forehead. The face that was so close to mine was as white as the face against the glass. And out of it presently came a sound, not low or weak, but as if from much farther away. That I drank like a waft of fragrance. Yes, I took it. At this, with a moan of joy I unfolded, I drew him close, and while I held him to my breast where I could feel in the sudden fever of his little body the tremendous pulse of his little heart, I kept my eyes on the thing at the window and saw it move and shift its posture. I have likened it to a sentinel, but its slow wheel, for a moment, was rather the prowl of a baffled beast. My present quickened courage, however, was such that, not too much to let it through, I had to shade, as it were, my flame. Meanwhile, the glare of the face was again at the window, and the scoundrel fixed as if to watch and wait. It was the very confidence that I might now defy him, as well as the positive certitude by this time of the child's unconsciousness that made me go on. What did you take it for? To see what you said about me. You opened the letter? I opened it. My eyes were now, as I held him off a little again, on Miles's own face, in which the collapse of mockery showed me how complete was the ravage of uneasiness. What was prodigious was that at last, by my success, his sense was sealed and his communication stopped. He knew that he was in presence, but knew not of what, and knew still less that I also was and that I did know. And what did this strain of trouble matter when my eyes went back to the window only to see that the air was clear again and, by my personal triumph, the influence quenched? There was nothing there. I felt that the cause was mine and that I should surely get all. And you found nothing, I let my elation out. He gave the most mournful little head shake. Nothing, 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 I almost shouted in my joy. Nothing, nothing, he sadly repeated. I kissed his forehead. It was drenched. So what have you done with it? I've burned it. Burned it? It was now or never. Is that what you did at school? Oh, what brought this up? At school? Did you take letters or other things? Other things? He appeared now to be thinking of something far off and that reached him only through the pressure of his anxiety. Yet it did reach him. Did I steal? I felt myself redden to the roots of my hair as well as wonder if it were more strange to put to a gentleman such a question or to see him take it with allowances that gave the very distance of his fall in the world. Was it for that you mightn't go back? The only thing he felt was rather a dreary little surprise. Did you know I mightn't go back? I know everything. No, you don't. Sorry. He gave me at this the longest and strangest look. Everything. Everything. Therefore, did you? But I could not say it again. Miles could, very simply. No, I didn't steal. My face must have shown that I believed him utterly, yet my hands, but it was for pure tenderness, shook him as if to ask him why, if it was all for nothing, he had condemned me to months of torment. Then what did you do? He looked in vague pain all round the top of the room and drew his breath, 2-3 times over, as if with difficulty. He might have been standing at the bottom of the sea and raising his eyes to some faint green twilight. Well, I said things. Only that. They thought it was enough. To turn you out for? Never truly a person turned out shone so little to explain as this little person. He appeared to weigh my question, but in a manner quite detached and almost helpless. Well, I suppose I oughtn't. But to whom did you say them? He evidently tried to remember, but it dropped. He had lost it. I don't know. He almost smiled at me in the desolation of his surrender, which was indeed practically, by this time, so complete that I ought to have left it there. But I was infatuated. I was blind with victory, though even then the very effect that was to have brought him so much nearer was already that of added separation. Was it to everyone? I asked. No, it was only two, but he gave a sick little headshake. I don't remember their names. Were there then so many? No, only a few. Those I liked. Those he liked. I seemed to float not into clearness, but into darker obscure. And within a minute there had come out to me of my very pity the appalling alarm of his being perhaps innocent. It was for the instant confounding and bottomless, for if he were innocent, what then on earth was I? Paralyzed while it lasted by the mere brush of the question, I let him go a little, so that with a deep-drawn sigh he turned away from me again, which, as he faced towards the clear window, I suffered, feeling that I had nothing now to keep him from. And did they repeat what you said? I went on after a moment. He was soon at some distance from me, still breathing hard and again with the air, though now without anger for it, a being confined against his will. Once more, as he had done before, he looked up at the dim day as if, of what had hitherto sustained him, nothing was left but an unspeakable anxiety. Oh yes, he nevertheless replied. They must have repeated them to those they liked. He added. There was, somehow, less of it than I had expected, but I turned it over. And these things came round to the masters. Oh, yes, he answered very simply. But I didn't know they'd tell. The masters? They didn't. They had never told. That's why I ask you. He turned to me again, his little beautiful fevered face. Yes, it was too bad. Too bad? What I suppose I sometimes said. To write home. I can't name the exquisite pathos of the contradiction given to such a speech by such a speaker. I only know that in the next instant I heard myself throw off with homely force, stuff and nonsense. But the next after that I must have sounded stern enough. What were these things? My sternness was all for his judge, his executioner, yet it made him avert himself again, And that movement made me, with a single bound and an irrepressible cry, spring straight upon him. For there again, against the glass, as if to blight his confession and stay his answer, was the hideous author of our woe, the white face of damnation. Well, of course he's back. I felt a sick swim at the drop of my victory and all the return of my battle, so that the wildness of my veritable leap only served as a great betrayal. I saw him from the midst of my act to meet it with a divination, and on the perception that even now he only guessed, and that the window was still to his own eyes free, I let the impulse flame up to convert the climax of his dismay into the very proof of his liberation. No more, no more, no more, I shrieked as I tried to press him against me to my visitant. Is she here? Miles panted as he caught with his sealed eyes the direction of my words. Then his strange she staggered me and, with a gasp, I echoed it. Miss Jessel, Miss Jessel, he with a sudden fury gave me back. I seized, stupefied his supposition, some sequel to what we had done to Flora, but this made me only want to show him that it was better still than that. It's not Miss Jessel, but it's at the window, straight before us. It's there, the coward horror, there for the last time. At this, after a second in which his head made the movement of a baffled dog's on a scent and gave a frantic little shriek for the air and light, he was at me in a white rage, bewildered, glaring vainly over the place and missing wholly, though it now, to my sense, filled the room like a taste of poison, the wide, overwhelming presence. Is he? I was so determined to have all my proof that I flashed into ice to challenge him. Whom do you mean by he? Peter Quint, you devil! His face gave again round the room, its convulsed supplication. Where? There in my ear still, his supreme surrender of the name and his tribute to my devotion. What does he matter now, my own? What will he ever matter? I have you. I launched at the beast, but he has lost you forever. Then for the demonstration of my work. There, there, I said to Miles. But he had already jerked straight around, stared, glared again, and seen but the quiet day. With the stroke of the loss I was so proud of, he uttered the cry of a creature hurled over an abyss, and the grasp with which I recovered him might have been that of catching him in his fall. I caught him, yes, I held him. It might be imagined with what a passion, but at the end of a minute I began to feel what it truly was I held. We were alone with the quiet day, and his little heart, dispossessed, had stopped. The end of the Turn of the Screw. Dear friends and fiends, I hope you enjoyed reading this very long story with me. It was ghostly and ghastly and grim to be sure, and now it is over. Do let me know what you think, and if you'd like me to read more stories like this. They do take a bit of time, but they are oh so fun to make and share. Let me know what you think about this story in the comments below. If it sort of pairs with your experience, if you've seen The Haunting of Bly, let me know how you like that compared to this. That one is actually made up of quite a few different ghost stories from the same author, so we have more stuff to read if that's your thing. But it's been a pleasure reading this story with you. So on this bittersweet note, I will bid you good night, farewell, good evening, stay spooky. And now off to sleep and dream what you will, or stay a while and enjoy another tale. Whichever you choose, I'll speak to you again. And until then, stay spooky, my friends. Good night.